Bible is God's word. He inspired it for us. He speaks through it to us.
Speak this over yourself this morning.
I think science really should be the study of God's majesty, of his awesomeness. That's what we're doing with science. We're trying to find out more about God's creation.
What this verse is saying is you look around and it has the stamp of an incredible creator, designer, artist all over it.
We are lovingly made by a God who wants a relationship with us. That's why Christianity is so important to me, because it is everything. Without it, we have literally nothing.
So I know deep down, however you've suppressed it, deep down, you have a sense that God is. You know that God is. What's more reasonable to believe? That an eternal God made the world, or that it made itself? That's what a banner does. It announces something with pride about somebody. Listen to this. His banner over you is love.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome. Good morning. Can you wave? I'm going to wave. Got my helper with me today. I'm going to wave. Say hiya. She'll say hi when we're walking off the stage. That's what she'll do. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to Bagland Community Church. I can see several faces in here. Visitors, newbies, regulars, you're all welcome, and it'd be great to have you hang around at the end, have a drink, have a biscuit with us, so we can get to know you a little bit today. So we've got a few people missing today. We've got the Talamis are in Turkey, I think. We've got a team of people in Romania. I'll talk about that in a second. So we've got a few people missing, but it's still going to be a great service. And we've got with us this morning Chris Webb, who I saw over here. Chris is Anne's son, and he's come to preach for us today. And Chris is the pastor of a church called Above Bar Church in Southampton. And so thank you so much for coming. But I know that you've not come just for this. Chris has come to celebrate a very special birthday in the family this weekend. So tomorrow is Dennis's 80th birthday. And I know Dennis will be watching online, so we could all wave to the cameras, shout happy birthday, give him a cheer, congratulations. Happy birthday, Dennis, for tomorrow. Have a great time celebrating all the family. It's great to have you with us today. Coming up over the summer months, we've got several great things coming up. So over August, during August, we have got a baptism service, which is always a special, always a great service. If it's something that you're thinking about, maybe getting baptized, or you want to know a little bit more, Neil's not here today, but there are other leaders here, or come and find me, and we'd love to chat to you about the possibility of being baptized. That's towards the end of August. But also, at the end of every service in August, we've got the Summer of Sundays, Sundays being the ice cream kind of Sundays. And so at the end of every service during August, we are going to have ice cream together. I think Neil said we'll do it down on the patio as long as the weather's nice. So that'll be a really nice thing. And if you've got friends that are coming to visit or family coming to visit, then it's going to be great services to invite them to. But then in September, we have also got some brilliant services to invite people to, especially people who don't know Jesus yet. Because during September, we've got our 20th anniversary, the church's 20th anniversary. And so, there we go. So September is the church's 20th anniversary, and so we're going to be doing several special things throughout September. So each of the four services over September will be really evangelistic, so looking at sharing the gospel, telling people who don't know about Jesus all about him. I'm a bit scared about what happens if I put it down. So four services, evangelistic, and at the end of each service, there's going to be a different kind of food. So we've got pizza, barbecue, hog roast, and a picnic, I believe. And so those are going to be amazing services to invite your friends to, your family, neighbours, librarians. Invite everybody to those services. They're going to be great and special services. So start praying about who you can bring along to those. And another group of people to pray for are the team in Romania. So most of the team arrived on Friday, and I believe that Craig has flown out today. Does anybody know? Yes? Okay, so Craig had a negative COVID test yesterday, finally, and so today he's able to fly over. So thank you, Lord, for answering our prayers for that. So the team actually start their work tomorrow with the children in the kids' camp and their families. So be praying for them as they share the news of Jesus and have fun and encourage these families. So it's with children with life-limiting illnesses. So it's going to be a really special time. So be praying for them this week. For those of you that want to celebrate the life of Sylvie Joyce, the funeral will be here on Monday, I think it is, July the 11th at 10:30 a.m. So if you want to come and celebrate Sylvie with us, then you are more than welcome. Today, John is going to be leading. If you're a baby or in comp group, then you can leave in the third song.
Good morning, guys. Good morning. Can you stand with me, please? As you stand, I'm just going to share with you a couple of verses from Colossians. It says this: once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Let me just repeat that last bit again for you. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. Just stand for a moment, bow your heads, and just let that truth sink in. If you're in Christ this morning, then there's no more condemnation, guys. God, we have a hope that can never perish, spoil, or fade. And if that doesn't stir you up, nothing will. Our God, we thank you for this incredible truth. We thank you for Jesus, God. We thank you, God, that although we stuff up day in, day out on times, we cling to you. And you hold us firmly in your hand. God, we know that we are safe. We know that there is a hope in you that no one can ever take away. We know that your love is everlasting, that your faithfulness endures forever. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your amazing grace. Help us, God, through this service, through the singing, God, and through the preaching of your word, God. I pray that you speak. I pray that you save. I pray that if there's anyone here who doesn't know you this morning, then they understand the gravity of their situation, that this isn't just a thing a couple of people do on a Sunday. This is a response to your the incredible truth that you have saved us, that you have made a way. Oh, God, help us this morning to respond in the right way. In your precious name, amen.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. Till I met you. You called my name. Out of the darkness into your glory.
is greater than anything, God. Oh, God, help us to live that way, God. Help us not to walk out this door later today and just completely forget. God, that's what we do, and we're sorry for it. But God, use this time, use this service now, God, to work through us by your Spirit, God, to change us, to make us bold, to make us strong, to make us trust you more. Not to be knocked by the things of this world as easy as we can do, God, but to be able to stand firm in your grace, stand firm in your love. God, you deserve the highest praise, and we're going to respond that way right now. But God, we just lift you up, and we say thank you, God. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the empty grave. Thank you that you've conquered sin, death, and hell. You've made a way. You've made a way for each and every one of us. In your precious name.
Lift my voice to sing of your goodness. I lift my voice to sing of your love. I lift my voice to sing hallelujah. Jesus our Savior, you're worthy of it all. Sing of your goodness. I lift my voice to sing of your love. I lift my voice to sing hallelujah. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it all. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. We give you the highest praise. Jesus, our Savior, you're worthy of it all.
and ask Chris now to come and share the word with us.
Not on. Not yet. It's not on yet. Press and hold till it goes off, and then press and hold until it says Sennheiser. What's it say on the screen?
It is on.
Yep, should see something now. Should come through.
Hello.
Hello. Right.
Hey. Okay, I should have had time to think of a good joke there, but I didn't. It's great to be here. I thought our band at Above Bar was good, but my, that was amazing. I'd never sung any of those songs before, but that was great. What a blessing. Lots of you I don't know. I've been coming to Baglan sort of once a year for several years. We were in Thailand for 5 years. We're now in Southampton. Above Bar Church is big. There's about 1,000 people associated with it. It's got 2 sites. But during the pandemic, we've gone through a massive transition. We've lost lots of staff. Actually, the senior pastor, his last Sunday is today. So now it's over to me. So good luck, Above Bar Church. No, we have lost a lot of staff. We're looking for a children's worker. We're going to look for a new senior pastor as well. We've got a lot of internationals, refugees, asylum seekers, homeless, people from all sectors of society that the church is trying to reach. It's right in the city center there, right in the precinct in Southampton. And then another site towards the east of the city, which I've been looking after, but we'll have to leave that now to concentrate more on the city. So we'll also need to appoint someone to look after the site in the east. So if you remember to pray for Above Bar Church, we've got a lot of needs. We're advertising, I think, for 4 or 5 staff positions at the moment. So yeah, but great to be here. This morning, I want to speak about the fatherhood of God. That's going to be my subject. So I'd like to read the Lord's Prayer, how Jesus taught us to pray in Matthew 6, verse 9 to 15. I think that's going to be on the screen. "This then is how you should pray," said Jesus. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." So, I mean, this Lord's Prayer has obviously been a big deal in the history of the Christian church. Many churches say it several times a day, the more liturgical churches. Hands up who prayed this prayer at school. We I had to sing it in Welsh. I know it all in Welsh. Ein Tad or in Hoitan and Evo and so on. We sung it. It's kind of easy to memorize. Every line reflects something that we need every day. But above all, we need to remember who we're praying to, our Father in heaven. And that's my subject. Last week, it would have worked better because it was Father's Day. But here we go. And 2 weeks ago, it was Trinity Sunday. That would have worked well as well. But the first thing I want to say is that Jesus and the Holy Spirit reveal that the one true God is Father. So, first of all, Jesus reveals God as Father. The writers of the Old Testament, they also believed in the fatherhood of God. The Psalms speak of God as being the father to the fatherless and the defender of widows and orphans. In Psalm 27, verse 10, David writes, "Even if my mother and my father forsake me, the Lord will hold me fast." But in the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, there are only 14 times where God is called Father, and there's not an individual, not Adam or Noah or Abraham or David or Daniel or anyone who prays, "Oh God, my Father." It seems like in the Hebrew Bible, the emphasis in terms of God's attributes is on his holiness, his otherness, and a need for a mediator to enable us to come into God's presence. But then Jesus comes and claims to be that mediator, claims to be the one who brings us near and reconciles us. And in John 14, Jesus says to his disciples, "He who's seen me has seen the Father." In other words, I am bringing you a fuller revelation of who God is as Father. And Jesus never used another term to pray to God apart from Father. 60 times he prayed Father, except once. When was that time? Do you remember? On the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? Quoting Psalm 22, very mysteriously, Jesus was bearing the separation that we deserve to bear so that we never will bear it when we're in Christ. The last time Jesus addressed God as his Father was when he ascended to heaven and he said to his disciples, "Go and tell my brothers, I'm ascending to your Father and to my Father." Jesus also reveals to us the Father heart of God, and he does that through the way he interacts with people and also the stories that he told. The most famous story, perhaps, is the two lost sons. Remember that story? One son, the younger one, requested his inheritance money early, as if he was wishing his father dead. And he went and spent it all and lost it. And there was a famine, and he was in a desperate situation, longing, it says Jesus in the story, to fill his stomach with the food that the pigs were eating. And he came to his senses, and he said to himself, "How many of my father's servants have food to spare, and here I am starving?" And so he rehearsed a speech as he went back to his father's house. And the speech went like this: "Father, I've sinned. Will you make me like one of your hired hands, your servants, because I've blown it? I'll relate to you now like an employee with an employer. Obviously, our lives can't be meshed together again because I it's like I wished you dead. I took the inheritance money." But the father sees his son from a distance and runs to him. And that is kind of weird because a distinguished Middle Eastern patriarch wouldn't run. Children might run, you know, women might run occasionally after the kids, young men might run, but a dignified pillar of the family, the pater familias, would not run. And yet here the father runs, showing his emotions openly, throws his arms around his son, kisses him, wouldn't let him go, wouldn't let him rehearse that fear-filled speech. He puts a robe on him, covering his nakedness and poverty and shame, and then organizes a feast, kills the fatted calf, and has this celebration. And so Jesus reveals the Father as one whose love and forgiveness can restore any kind of wrongdoing. There's no evil that the Father's love cannot pardon or cover, no sin that is a match for his amazing grace. The other son is actually upset about that attribute of the Father. And he tells the Father, that's just not fair. I've been slaving for you all these years, and you've never thrown me a party. That's a picture of religion. In religion, you do the religious stuff, you work for God, and he pays you back. But there's no relationship. And so the second son also disrespects and disgraces his father in the way that he speaks to him and acts to him, just like the younger son. But the father also pleads with the older son. In the story, in Jesus' story in Luke chapter 15, the father begs the older son to come inside and celebrate. Please, swallow your pride. Come into the feast. Your brother was lost and is found. But the hearts of the two brothers, even though they acted differently, were the same. Both resented their father's authority. Both wanted to get into a position where they could tell the father what to do. Both were using the father for their own self-centered ends. One was doing it through keeping the rules. One was doing it through breaking the rules. One was doing it through morality. One was doing it through immorality. And yet, the father loves them both and wants to celebrate with them both. And this parable is important because Jesus is revealing the father heart of God, the father heart of compassion and kindness and patience and grace in a very brutal first century world where the poor were scorned. But Jesus says, when you pray, "Our Father in heaven," you know you're coming to a God of grace and mercy and forgiveness and patience who's waiting for you to come to your senses and leave your pride and just be enveloped in this grace and forgiveness and love. And clearly the invitation is always open, no matter where you've been, what you've done, what decisions you've previously taken, the Father's arms are open wide. So Jesus reveals the one true God to be this Father. The Holy Spirit, we're in the realm of mystery again, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit also reveals God as Father. Romans 8, 15 to 16 says this, "The Spirit that you've received doesn't make you slaves again so that you fear, but the Spirit has brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him you cry out, Abba," the Aramaic word for daddy, Abba, Father. The Spirit, Holy Spirit, testifies with your spirit, your inner being, that you are God's children. How do you know that you're a Christian, a believer, a child of God, that you've been adopted? How does that objective reality become a subjective, felt by you experience? It's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit reveals to you inwardly you're a child of God. So you cry out from the gut. You want to pray, Abba, Father. What's the implication of that? Well, one implication is you can know God with all the confidence and intimacy and shamelessness and utter abandon and absolute trust with which a little child reaches for their daddy. And therefore, the God that is revealed in the Bible and through Jesus most fully and by the Holy Spirit internally is not the same as God's worshipped in other religions. I know we live in a pluralistic society. We have Buddhism and Hinduism and Islam, and a lot of people think Christianity is the same. In Southampton, we've got a religion of supporting Southampton Football Club. Do you know what it's called? Masochism. But the God revealed by Jesus and the Holy Spirit is different, so deeply relational. The relationship with Allah is a relationship of submission. Islam means submission. He is the master, you are the servant, you submit. But the overriding relationship revealed with God is father to children. And the Holy Spirit enables us to cry out from the gut, Abba. You know, there's nothing like the way a baby holds you. You know, when they grow to children, smaller children, it's slightly different. But when a baby holds you, they utterly trust you. And the Spirit says to us, you can trust God in that way. There'll be times when your parents let you down, your partners let you down, and your politicians let you down. But the Spirit says to you, there is somebody who you can absolutely trust. He is your Father in heaven, that realm of righteousness and truth and justice and all the things by which we like to judge the world around us. When I went to Uganda on a mission trip in 2002, there was a song the Ugandans sang in parts. First part was sung by the men. And it went like this, your wife will let you down, your wife will let you down, your wife will let you down, but Jesus never fails. And then even louder, the women would sing, your husband will let you down, your husband will let you down. And it went on like this. But the Lord, the Father, will never let you down. In him you are safe. Because the eternal state of God is the Father loving the Son through the Spirit, an eternal community of love. And the invitation of the gospel is, come into the community that has already existed for all eternity. So that's the first point. Jesus and the Spirit reveal God as Father. Second point is, addressing God as Father from the gut is a sign that you really know him. In Aramaic, the word Father, the word Abba, means daddy. And in every language, I think infants, little children, babies, reach out for mummy and daddy and they want to use words that don't require teeth. Mama, dada. There's something really basic about this. From childhood, every human being is looking for someone who will love them unconditionally, who will never let them down, who will always be there, who is trustworthy. And Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, says, this is the Father from whom all fatherhood derives its name, and we can know him. I wonder if you do know him this morning, or if you want to know him. In his great book called Knowing God, anyone read that book? Knowing God by J.I. Packer, a few people. There's a chapter on adoption, and it's the best chapter in the book. And in it, he says this, if you want to judge how well a person understands Christianity, find out how much he makes of the thought of being God's child and knowing God as Father. If this is not the thought that prompts and controls your life, then you don't understand Christianity very well at all. Father is the Christian name for God. Lots of us might have different kind of warped views of who God is, what he's like. But J.I. Packer says, if you want to know how well a person understands Christianity, judge how much he makes of the thought of being God's child. Another book is called I Dared to Call Him Father by a Pakistani lady called Bilquis Sheikh. Has anyone read that book? Yeah, a few of you. She was a high-born Pakistani lady married to the Minister of Interior in Pakistan. Her world fell apart. He left her. But just before then, she began to have dreams in which Jesus appeared to her in these dreams. She'd never read the Bible or met Christians, but she had these dreams. And in these dreams, Jesus started to reveal the true God, who she called Allah, as Father. And she said that as she got to know God as Father, love replaced harshness in her life. She used to be very harsh, she admitted, towards her servants. But then she began to be empathetic towards them and love them. And as she dared to call him Father, intimacy and love flowed into her life and then out from her life. Converting to Christianity obviously meant she had to leave the country. And she was cut off by people in Pakistan and had to leave. But she says in the book, knowing Abba Father meant that she was embraced by this community of love in a way that had never happened to her before. To know the Father is to be immersed in love. Another book, or a couple of books, is a guy called Mike Reeves, and he's written a book called Delighting in the Trinity, and another smaller book called The Good God. And in both books, in the first chapter, he asks the question, what was God doing before creation? What was God doing before creation? What do you think? Before he created anything, what was God doing? He says the answer to that question determines what you think about God. What was God doing before he created anything? The answer is given to us by Jesus in John 17. Jesus prays, Father, you've loved me since before the creation of the world. You see, the eternal state of God is love. Can't be said of Allah, because who is Allah loving? But if the Father is loving the Son, the Spirit is loving the Father, then love is the core of who God is. He is a community of love from eternity. And he invites people into this feast and into this fellowship. And I think at bottom, this is actually what every human being is yearning for, to be embraced by a community of love, to join a community of love. I used to go and drink pints and play snooker with the old men on Fridays and Saturdays. But we were all wanting to join a community of love, yearning for a community of love. In Mesopotamian and Greek and Roman religion, the creation of the world came about through a fight between the gods. According to the Bible, though, the world was created by a loving God, by a community of love, a loving Father in collaboration with the Son and the Holy Spirit. Another book to go further in knowing God as Father is Floyd McClung's book called The Father Heart of God. And in that book, he makes the point, which is my third point, that knowing God as Father is healing. Many of you here, you might have grown up without a dad. Some of you, your dad was absent or distant or negligent or drunk or violent or both. But all of us have father wounds in some way. And some of us have inflicted father wounds on our own children by not being the kind of dads we should have been. But for many, the concept of father evokes responses of anger and resentment and rejection or sadness. Because you haven't known a kind earthly father, you've got a distorted view of who the heavenly Father that Jesus and the Holy Spirit reveals might be. And you need to be healed. And some of us this morning, maybe we need to bow before God and we need to simply say, Abba, Father, heal me. And be healed in his presence. try not to resent the failings of your human parents. You know, your dad was just a kid who grew up and had kids himself. But rejoice in the love of your Father, in whom you are safe and loved and protected and welcomed and celebrated for who you are. That's a distinctly Christian teaching, that is. But knowing God as Father brings confidence and security and wholeness. When my kids were really little, Isaac would climb up on this climbing frame and just jump down. I would catch him. It never occurred to him that I wouldn't catch him. And in some ways, that's the Father. He's always there to catch us when we fall, and fall we will. Our Father gives us great confidence and security and healing. He's always understanding, always caring, always loving, never forgetting us. And he surpasses all that is human in love because he is our Father in heaven, that realm where he rules and reigns in love. In John's first letter, the third chapter, verse 1, he says this, "Behold, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God," and that is what we are. To experience love lavished in our lives is what every human being yearns for, and is the most healing and permanently transforming thing that can happen to a human being. I know many of you are anxious after the pandemic, doubtless. Many of you are apprehensive. Keen used to sing a song, didn't he? "Everything changes, but I don't feel the same. But one thing that will never change is your Father's steadfast love. That's a reason to hope and celebrate in any darkness." But to be a Christian is not to just simply have God in a general sense or just to believe something out there, but you cross the line. When you become a Christian, the Holy Spirit comes into you, and God actually lavishes his love into your life and gives you a status, children. But not just legally. His love alters who you are, because as children of God, you are born again, says Jesus, and you're given part of this divine nature, and he's transforming your life into the image of the Father and healing you. So come to the Father this morning and be healed. I don't know if you have a prayer time after the service. I would definitely pray with anyone who would like to pray to be healed, to know this Father's healing love. You don't need to do anything to convince him to love you, but you do need to open yourself to receive his love. Human beings can be very hard and shut the door very closed. You do need to open your heart to receive his love. John says, "Behold, open the door. Behold, see what great love the Father has lavished on you." Don't just let the truth stand over you. Let it envelop you. Don't just know this in a detached way. Make the connections. If this is true, that thing that's weighing you down, that thing that causes you to lose sleep, your Father's got it. It's okay. Don't be afraid of the unknown future, because it's not unknown to him. His plans for you are good. I'm preaching to myself here too. But let the fatherhood of God move from your mind to your heart, from analysis to intuition by the Holy Spirit. Let his fatherhood heal you. God's love heals the hurts of men and women, of old men, of young men, young women, old women, children alike. You are the apple of his eye. Let me pray. As I pray, I think of that old chorus, "Father God, I wonder how I managed to exist without the knowledge of your parenthood and your loving care. Now I am your child. I'm adopted in your family. And I will sing your praises." Lord, we sing your praises, and Lord, we want to know you in a greater way. Thank you for how Jesus revealed the one true God, to be Father. And the criteria by which we judge the world through the lens of compassion and pity and patience, it's distinctly Christian. It's who you are. Thank you that you're a good, good Father. And I pray that if there are any here that need that healing touch of the Father this morning, that you would meet with them by the Spirit. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. We'll certainly be praying for you in your church when you go for all these changes. I know how stressful that can be, so I pray that you get the right people in, that you listen to God, and that he leads you to those people. But I know when you're talking about five or six changes, what you mentioned, that can be really unsettling. So we'll definitely be praying for you as a church, mate. Thank you for this morning as well. Guys, we stand together. I was going to share a verse with you, but they're all golden. I'm only going to go for the first one. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Should we respond together? God, we thank you and we praise you for your word here this morning, God, that you are a loving and gracious Father, that we can run to you and your arms are wide open and we fall into that incredible loving embrace. God, we thank you that you're not some distant God, that you want to be with us, that you want to lead us, you want to carry us through. God, we thank you, God, for that incredible, incredible truth that we have just sung there. That one day we will be with you in heaven forever. God, that this life is almost just a slight little blip and then bang, we're with you for eternity. Help us, God, whatever we're going through here, God, individually and collectively, God, to know and to trust that you are in control. To know and to trust that you will lead us through. God, and that includes Chris and the changes in his church as well, that he knows and they trust together that God will lead him through, that the changes that will be made, the people that will come in will be right for that church, God. So I just pray, God, that for each and every one of us now, God, that we know you as Father, that we know you as a loving Father. Oh, thank you, God, for your incredible grace. Thank you that you never give up. And your world and your word holds true. And we pray all this in your precious name. Amen. Please take your seats, guys. Feel free to stay and hang around later. There's some teas and coffees and whatnot around by there, so it'll be good to chat to you.